Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 1119. House Bill 1119.
House Bill 1119 by Representative Sims of 169th. Bill to be entitled Act provides that future elections for the office of Judge, Probate Court of Atkinson County shall be nonpartisan elections. Provide for submission of this act for preclearance under the Federal Voting Rights Act, the Rights Act of 1965 as amended. Bill has been before the House Committee on Intergovernmental Coordination. The committee recommends the bill to pass, and the bill is being read today for its third time.
Chair recognizes Chairman Sims to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, this is a simple bill. All it does is it changes my probate judge in Atkinson County from a partisan to a nonpartisan election. I'll stand for any questions.
You have no questions. Gentleman has yielded the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 1119 will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of House Bill 1119. The ayes are 147, the nays are 7. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 1120. House Bill 1120.
House Bill 1120 by Representative Sims, 169. Bill to be entitled Act by the future elections. Office of Chief Magistrate Judge in Atkinson County shall be nonpartisan elections. By submission of this act for preclearance of the Federal Voting Rights Act of 1965 as amended. Bill has been before the House Committee on Intergovernmental Coordination. The committee recommends the bill be passed. It's being read today for the third time.
Chair recognizes Chairman Sims to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And ladies and gentlemen of the House, again, I bring you a change of partisan to nonpartisan election for my magistrate judge in Atkinson County. I'll stand for any questions.
You have no questions.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 1120 will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines. On the passage of House Bill 1120, the ayes are 145, the nays are 10. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 1121. House Bill 1121.
House Bill 1121 represents Sims 169. Bill to be entitled Act by the future elections for the office of Chief Magistrate Judge of Coffee County shall be nonpartisan election by submission of this act for preclearance under the Federal Voting Rights Act 1965 as amended. Bill has been before the House Committee on Intergovernmental Coordination. Committee recommends the bill do pass. The bill is being read today for the third time.
Chair recognizes Chairman Sims to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This is my last one on this one. This is my chief magistrate judge in Coffee County changing from partisan to nonpartisan election. Any questions? Okay, I yield well.
You have a question if you care to yield.
Yeah, I yield. I'll yield.
You were on a pretty good roll there.
I know it.
Chair recognizes Chairman Rogers to your right for a question.
Yes, sir.
Gentlemen, yield.
I certainly will.
Have you got anybody else left down there that's partisan besides yourself?
Yeah. Everybody's partisan except for these judges. I tried to do a little bill this year to try to get all these judges changed, and we're still working on that fact.
Will you further yield?
Certainly
will. Would you like to run nonpartisan?
No, sir, I would not.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Gentleman has yielded the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 1121 will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of House Bill 1121. The ayes are 144, the nays are 16. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 827. House Bill 827.
House Bill 827, Representative Henry the 67th, a bill to be entitled Act Amendment Title 40 relating to serious traffic offenses, so with modified provisions relating to fleeing or attempting to elude a pursuing police vehicle or police officer to increase the penalty for fleeing or attempting to elude under certain circumstances. Bill has been for the House Committee on Public Safety, Homeland Security. Committee recommends the bill do pass. The bill is being read today for the third time.
Chair recognizes Chairman Hembree to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Good afternoon, members of the House. I'd like to ask you to support House Bill 827. House Bill 827 is supported by the Georgia State Patrol. There's a letter, a very strong letter, heartfelt letter from Colonel McDonough on your desk. I hope you'll read that if you have not already. Very, very strong letter in support of this measure. It's also supported by the Georgia Associations of Chiefs of Police and also the Georgia Sheriff's Association. So I appreciate them and their support of this measure. This is a great law enforcement bill you can take home during the campaign season this fall and summer and tell the folks back home that you were supporting your local law enforcement. The bill truly helps law enforcement because it creates a consistency in felony prosecutions. For example, under current law, a suspect who flees while drinking and driving cannot be charged with a felony, no matter how fast they were driving or who they injured during the fleeing incident. But a person with drugs in their car can be charged with a felony. So this bill just simply fixes this, that both types of suspects can be charged with a felony under the five provisions in the current law. We are making these changes so that the traffic violations will be consistent with other violations. That's all we're doing. If you just look at the current code section I've placed on your desk, you will see how difficult the current law is to understand. I've got that on your desk too. It's very confusing. This is a good measure, and I hope you'll support it because it's good for Georgia and it's good for our law enforcement officers. I'll be glad to yield for any questions.
You have a question if you care to yield.
Yes, sir.
Chair recognizes Representative Darlene Taylor to your right for a question.
Will the gentleman yield?
Yes, ma'am, I'll yield.
Is it not true that this bill really just simplifies and clarifies the existing code, and it's going to serve our motoring public and law enforcement?
Yes, ma'am, the lady is correct.
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, I yield the well.
The gentleman has yielded the well. Is there objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Clerk will read the amendment, which has been approved by the Rules Committee. Clerk will read.
Representative Hembree, the 67th, offers the following amendment, Amendment HB 827, and the amendment is printed in your calendar books, upper right-hand corner, AM 350274.
Is there objection to adopting the amendment AM 350274? The chair hears none. The amendment is adopted. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 827 will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of House Bill 827. The ayes are 164. The nays are 2. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 851. House Bill 851.
House Bill 851, Representative Rice, 51st, a bill of entitled Acting Code Section 48673, relating to reports and distributions regarding the taxation of intangibles, was changed certain requirements regarding the rates to be charged by collecting officers. The bill had been for the House Committee on Ways and Means. Committee recommends the bill to be passed by a committee substitute. The bill is being read today for the third time.
Chair recognizes Chairman Rice to present the bill.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. House Bill 851 is a simple population bill that really maintains the status quo in the large counties in the metro area. With regard to the fees for recording, the intangible recording tax fees, they're applicable to Fulton, Cobb, Gwinnett, and DeKalb. And that's basically all the bill does, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Speaker, keeps everything the same.
You have no questions? Gentleman has yielded the will. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered on House Bill 851? The chair hears none. Previous question is ordered. There is a minority report. There is a minority report on House Bill 851. Chair recognizes as the first signer, Representative Taylor. He waves. Second signer, Representative Flood, waves. Okay, there will not be speaking to the minority report. Is there any objection to adopting the committee substitute? The chair hears none. The committee substitute is adopted. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 851 will vote aye. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of House Bill 851. The ayes are 145, the nays are 22. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 1051. House Bill 1051.
House Bill 1051, Representative Jacobs, the 80th. Bill to be entitled Act Amendment Title 32 relating to mass transportation, so as repeal provisions related to suspension restrictions on the use of annual proceeds from sales and use taxes by public transit authorities, to repeal provisions relating to the Board of Directors of the Metropolitan Atlanta Rapid Transit Authority about related matters. Bill hasn't been before the House Committee on Transportation. The committee recommends this bill to pass. Bill's being read today for its third time.
Chair recognizes Chairman Jacobs.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, I bring before you House Bill 1051. This bill repeals two provisions that were adopted in the General Code as part of the Transportation Investment Act, House Bill 277, relating to MARTA, one relating to the structure of the MARTA board, the other relating to the 50-50 split. House Bill 1052, which will come up in a couple of minutes, moves these provisions back into the MARTA Act, and so all 1051 does is repeals these two provisions from the General Code. I'll ask for the House's favorable consideration of House Bill 1051, and Mr. Speaker, I yield the well.
You have some questions. He yields the well. Gentleman has yielded the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 1051 will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines on the passage of House Bill 1051. The ayes are 128. The nays are 40. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. The clerk will read the caption to House Bill 1052. House Bill 1052.
House Bill 1052 by Representative Jacobs of the 80th, a bill to be entitled Act to amend an act known as the Metropolitan Atlanta Rapid Transit Authority Act of 1965 so as to reconstitute the Board of Directors, provide for staggered terms for board members, provide for a limit on reappointment of board members, and provide for a method of non-participating counties to join the authority, to prohibit the authority from entering into certain transactions, provide for suspension restrictions on the use of sales and use tax proceeds. Bill hadn't been before the House Committee on Transportation. The committee recommends bill passed by committee substitute. Bill's being read today for the third time.
Chair recognizes Chairman Jacobs to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, this is the other bill in that pair, House Bill 1052. This bill results from the work of a subcommittee on MARTOC that I have appointed, chaired by Representative Riley, that is charged with taking a look periodically at the MARTA Act, the enabling legislation for MARTA, and suggesting updates and changes to it. That subcommittee met several times between the last legislative session and this legislative session. They heard from MARTA, and in fact, in this bill, there are provisions that were suggested by MARTA, and they also undertook a comprehensive review of the MARTA Act and made some changes on that basis as well. As I said, there were two provisions that were adopted as part of the Transportation Investment Act that are now being brought back into the MARTA Act. That was the bill that we just adopted to repeal those out of the General Code. What this bill does with regard to the MARTA Act is as follows. Section 1 of the bill looks like it shrinks the size of the MARTA board, but actually it keeps the MARTA board at the same size. We already shrunk the size of the MARTA board in the Transportation Investment Act. We're keeping the same number of members. However, the Fulton County government has three appointees, two from north of the city of Atlanta, one from south of the city of Atlanta. We are moving the two North Fulton appointments to a caucus of the mayors of North Fulton County in deference to the fact that that entire area is now in one city or another. We also move one DeKalb County appointment of DeKalb's four appointments from the DeKalb DeKalb County Board of Commissioners to a caucus of the mayors of DeKalb County. Right now, there is a voting appointment with the commissioner of the Georgia Department of Transportation, and the executive director of GRETA sits as a non-voting member. We are moving the voting member to the executive director of GRETA. Then we have made the non-voting member the planning director of the Georgia Department of Transportation. There is an amendment on that was done in the House Transportation Committee. There is an amendment in your books where we had missed one place where that should have been added in, and so that's all that the amendment does. In addition, Section 1 staggers the board terms of the MARTA Board of Directors. When we adopted the Transportation Investment Act, we failed to provide for that staggering, so all of the members come onto the board and leave the board at the same time. Under the current law, this staggers the board terms. Section 2 of the bill relates to procurement. In that provision right now, there is a provision in the MARTA Act that says that MARTA does not have to go through a competitive bidding process with regard to consulting contracts and professional services contracts. We are making clear in the MARTA Act that they nevertheless have to go through a request for proposals process, or they have to follow federal law with regard to procurement, but they have to use a transparent process in order to do procurement for professional services contracts. We're also deleting a provision that says that with regard to putting a request for bids out, if they do not get a bid, they're able to then go and negotiate with whomever they want. Now we're going to make clear that if you don't get one bid when you do a request for bids, you have to put that back. You have to revise your request and put that back out for bid so that there is no gaming of the system in that regard. Section 3 of the bill is a request from MARTA. What this does is right now, MARTA has to provide paper copies of financial reports to every local government in a 5-county area, cities and counties, in Fulton, DeKalb, Cobb, Gwinnett, and Clayton counties. They actually have to provide paper copies of financial reports. This makes it clear that they can just simply post that on the web and point the local governments to where these are located on the web rather than doing this via paper copies. Section 4 of the bill provides for a 10-year look back on their capital improvements budget so that when MARTA does its capital improvements budget, they have to benchmark that and show what they have managed to do with regard to what they've budgeted over the past 10 years and what their progress has been over the past 10 years when adopting their capital improvements budget on a going forward basis. And finally, Section 5 of the bill just brings back into the MARTA Act the provision that we adopted in the Transportation Investment Act with regard to the 50-50 split. This would keep the 50-50 split relaxed through the middle of 2013, which is the current state of the law. We're just bringing the current state of the law home into the MARTA Act. Mr. Speaker, that is House Bill 1052 in a nutshell. A lot of hard work has gone into this bill, both on MARTOC and the Transportation Committee. I would commend it to the members of the House. I will yield for a couple of questions, and then, Mr. Speaker, I will yield the well.
You have a lot of questions.
Well, I'll take a couple.
Chair recognizes Chairman Earhart to your right for a question.
Gentlemen, yield.
I do.
Gentlemen, on page 3, if you'll take a look at line 88 and 89, I'd like to ask you a question about how that's constructed. It says the local governing bodies of Cobb, Clayton, and Gwinnett County may, and you can take out the clause, but enter into and submit qualified voters may submit to the qualified voters. It doesn't say that they shall submit for a referendum. It says they may submit for a referendum. And then further on in that paragraph, it says they shall be authorized to enter into a contract previous to that referendum. Can you give me some idea of why you can enter into a contract previous to the referendum? Why you would want to?
Well, I think, first of all, it's important to point out, Chairman Earhart, that that is an importation to the letter of the provision that we adopted back in 2010. It absolutely is an importation of that provision back into the MARTA Act. In any event, okay,
it said shall, then, I'm pardon? Sure. My recollection was it said shall submit for the referendum in 2010.
No, it. All right. Would the gentleman point me to the provision once again?
On page 88. I'm sorry, on page 3, lines 88 and 89. It says the local governing body of those counties may submit to the qualified voters.
Right.
Of their respective counties, the approval of the question. And then you go on down, and it says that they can actually enter into the contract. They shall be authorized. You have a disconnect between may have a referendum and shall enter into a contract.
No, it's not shall. It's not shall enter into a contract. It's that they shall be authorized to enter into a contract, but they still have to do the referendum in order to do that. I mean, we were crystal clear about that in the Transportation Committee. Furthermore, I can assure you that this is a verbatim move of what is in the general code, because I line by lined it, of what is in the general code to the MARTA Act.
Okay, let me will the gentleman further you for one more question?
Certainly.
All right, then I have your absolute assurance that there is no way that you can enter into this contract and have that contract be valid
without a referendum.
Without a referendum. That even is, though it says you only may.
That is true here, and that is definitely true reading the MARTA Act as a whole. You have my assurance on that, Chairman Earhart.
Fair enough.
All right. I'll yield for one more questioner, Mr. Speaker.
You do have other questions?
One more.
One more. Chair recognizes Representative Gardner to your left for a question.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Will the gentleman yield?
I will.
Is it not true that if we were to eliminate Section 5 from this bill, it might be a reasonable bill? Are you?
If we were to eliminate Section 5 from this bill, it would leave the 50-50 split. It would actually put the 50-50 split into place immediately upon the governor's signature. Or, I'm sorry, as of January 1st, 2013, which is the effective date of the bill.
Is it not true that in the previous bill we repealed that section?
In the previous bill we repealed that section? No, what we did in the previous, there is a 3-year relaxation of the 50-50 split. Let me be very clear about this. There is a 3-year relaxation of the 50-50 split through mid-2013 that is in the general code. We just repealed it. If that bill goes forward and if we were to take Section 5 out of this bill, the effect of that would be that the 50-50 split would come back into play January 1st, 2013, rather than the middle of 2013. That would be the effect of that.
Even though it's been repealed.
That is correct. Mr. Speaker, I yield the well and ask for the House's favorable consideration of House Bill 1052.
The gentleman has yielded the well. There is one member that wanted to speak on this measure, but I'm going to take the liberty to ask you to help me welcome. He's just came by to say hello. Representative Roger Bruce. Boy, we're glad to see you. I'm going to ask your wife now to make sure that she does what you promised her you would do and leave and go home. Okay, we have no members that wanted to be heard on the bill. No members. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to adopting the amendment, AM390011? Mr. Clerk, read the amendment.
Representative Jacobs, the 80th, and others offer the following amendment in the House Committee on Transportation, substitute to House Bill 1050. This amendment, printed in your calendar books, upper right-hand corner, AM390011.
Is there any objection to adopting the amendment? Chair hears none. The amendment is adopted. Somebody. We have a minority report on 1052. Did anybody? It's not signed. Anyone speaking to the minority report? Waived. Okay. The amendment has been adopted. The previous question has been ordered. Is there any objection to adopting the committee substitute as amended? The chair hears none. The committee substitute as amended is adopted. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 1052 will vote aye. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. They'll be making a difference. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines. On the passage of House Bill 1052, the ayes are 115, the nays are 55. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 861. House Bill 861.
House Bill 861, Representative Hardin of 28. A bill to be entitled Act Amendment Title 35 relating to law enforcement officers so as to require law enforcement agencies to report drug-related arrests to the Department of Human Services. Amendment Title 49 relating to general provisions of public assistance so as to require drug testing for applicants and recipients of state-administered TANF benefits. Drive for legislative intent. Bill has been for the House Committee on Judiciary. Committee recommends this bill passed by committee substitute. Bill is being read today for the third time.
Pursuant to the action by the House Rules Committee, debate on this measure has been limited to no more than 1 hour, the time to be allocated at the discretion of the chair, and the chair is going to allocate 30 minutes to those proposing the measure and 30 minutes to those opposing the measure. Let's have order, please. We're on the rules calendar, and I know most members want to hear the debate and the presentation. Chair recognizes Representative Hardin to present the bill. Representative Hardin.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Members of the House, I bring before you House Bill 861 to require those receiving public assistance in this state to submit to drug screens with the Department of Human Resources. I'm going to go briefly through the sections of the bill and outline it and be open to questions if you have them. Starting off with Section 1 simply outlines the intent of the bill. Section 2 provides for some general definitions, and under Section B of 2, to give you a little bit of a background on as to how these tests will apply. Someone applying for TANF benefits, which is temporary assistance for needy families in this state, will submit to a drug screen, and once they are on TANF and receiving the taxpayer dollars of this state in the form of benefits, they will be subject to one random drug screen per year. If and when, or if they fail a drug screen, the first offense, they will be removed from TANF benefits until they come back and test clean, which could be perhaps the next month. A second violation or a second failed drug screen would require them to lose those benefits for 2 years, and the third drug screen would require them to lose benefits indefinitely. One of the big questions in this bill is, what about the children? And that's a great question. It's a question that we've is honestly the intent of this bill is threefold. It is to protect the taxpayers of this state and ensure that their tax dollars are being used wisely, and then they are not being used to subsidize illegal drug activity. And the second one is to ensure that those children in those homes are getting the benefits that are intended through them to them through TANF. The third one is to ensure that these people get the attention they deserve, that they are noticed by DFACS, if you will, and that we're able to get them the treatment to get them on the road to recovery, which is the intent in the end of temporary assistance in this state, is to help people with a hand up. Section 2, subsection C, provides for the safety resource. If children are taken from the home, if children are taken from a parent who fails a drug screen, those children will go under the current DHR rules. They will go to what is known as a safety resource. That is usually a relative, if not a close family member. They will be subject to a drug screen, and at that point, the children will go with them. The benefits will follow the children, so no children are falling through the cracks on this. There is conditions for appeal within DHR. That's Section D, Section 2. The cost of the benefits will be deducted from, or the cost of the drug screen, rather, will be deducted from their benefits at a cap of $40 a year. Currently, drug screens with DHR are somewhere between $23 and $30. So we're talking about a deduction in their benefits of about $3 per month. These results, unlike other states, these results in this bill are not subject to disclosure to any other department or any other agency. This is not a gotcha game. These are not going to be turned over to law enforcement for civil or criminal proceedings. This is strictly with DHR to ensure that these folks hit the radar screen, that the children get the benefits that they deserve,
and that the taxpayers of this state are protected. With that, Mr. Speaker, I anticipate a couple of questions, so I'll yield if there are none.
It looks like you have a few questions.
That's about how many I plan to take, Mr. Speaker. Yes, sir. I yield.
Okay. Let's see. Chair recognizes Representative Williams to your right for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Would the gentleman yield?
Absolutely.
Who pays for this drug screen?
The recipients. Those okay. receiving the benefits.
Follow up.
Yes, sir.
After they've been charged with a drug test, can they then vote?
Well, you're not charged with a drug test, but if they submit to a drug test and they are positive for a drug screen, that's a misdemeanor. Absolutely, they can vote. This is strictly interdepartmental. This is strictly within DHR to get them the help to ensure the children are getting their benefits. So this is not turned over to law enforcement. There are no civil or criminal charges being made. This is simply to protect the taxpayers of this state and the children of those homes.
Let me ask you this. Would the gentleman further you?
Yes, sir.
Couldn't a state benefit more if they were given treatment to the person instead of charging them with the drug act?
They could, and that's the intent of my bill. I don't know many drug addicts that freely admit they're drug addicts, so this is going to help get them on the radar screen so we can get them the help that they deserve. Great point.
Well, there's people that don't admit they have a DUI either. Thank you.
You do yield for more questions?
Yes, sir, Mr. Speaker.
Chair recognizes Representative Byrd to your right for a question.
Does the gentleman yield?
Yes, ma'am.
Is it not true that the state of Florida saw a drop of 48% of TANF applications?
That is absolutely correct. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Do you yield for further questions?
Yes, sir.
Chair recognizes Representative Reese to your right for a question.
Thank you. Does the gentleman yield?
Yes, ma'am.
If you'll look in line 64, page 3, denying TANF benefits if the applicant or recipient fails a drug test, what if that applicant is on prescribed medications? My concern is being able to tell the difference in an illegal substance and a prescribed medication.
Great question, Representative. It's current policy within DHR that if there are drugs noticed on the drug screen, it is a positive that they could submit a prescription or letters from a doctor notifying them of that, and it's all negated. It's all taken care of. So this is for illegal drugs. Legal prescriptions are not affected whatsoever. Yes, ma'am. Mr. Speaker, there's a few people signed up to speak. I'll take one more question.
One more question. Okay. Chair recognizes Representative Williams to your left for a question. He waves. Chair recognizes Representative Dobbs to your left for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Does the gentleman wave?
Yes, I'll yield. Yes, ma'am.
I yield. We've spoken about this, and you know that I'm very concerned about the children of these families, and considering that in Florida applications have dropped by close to 50%, and if the individual who takes the drug test and the test comes back positive no longer can receive those benefits, since the family of three gets less than $250 a month, how do you think that this is going to affect the children of that individual? And are they going to be able to afford their housing and food and needs?
Great question. I'll try to pick that apart there. The first thing, in regards to the less than, I think you said $200 for a family of three, Those numbers aren't correct. It's all over the map. It could be upwards to $700, even $1,000 a month for a family of three. In regards to housing, and I'm with you, we agree on the same end game. Maybe the procedure to get there is not necessarily the same, but the intent of this bill is to protect the children, and it is to ensure that that they are with an adult, with a guardian that is taking care of those benefits and making sure the children have what they need. You brought up the point in committee about if people would have the money to pay their mortgages, to which you and I have discussed, but since you brought it up here on the floor, I don't know a lot of drug addicts that are good money managers. They're just not. You know, I don't know that any drug dealer's ever gotten the response, you know, could you cut that bag of weed in half because I got a mortgage due this week. It just doesn't happen. So these folks aren't currently, are probably not taking care of their responsibilities as it stands. And this is going to ensure that they are. This is going to ensure that those children are taken care of. And when they're safety resource to a family member, nine times out of 10 in defects, that's a grandparent. These kids are going to be taken care of with these dollars, and that's who it's intended for. But thank you for the question. Mr. Speaker, there's a few people signed up. I'll yield the well.
Gentleman has yielded the well. We do have some members that have signed up to speak on the measure. Okay, we have members that have signed up. I will remind the members that each side has a total of 30 minutes, and time will be called at the end, so be considerate of your colleagues. Chair recognizes Representative Frazier to speak to the bill. Representative Frazier.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise today to speak against House Bill 861. This bill violates the common decency of the citizens of the state of Georgia. It creates a separate class of citizens by singling out one group of recipients of public benefits and subjecting them to measures that other recipients of public benefits are not subjected to. Because this group of people is distinguished only by the lack of economic advantages, House Bill 861 can be seen as nothing but an act of class warfare. Further, the bill will subject this group of people to a financial burden that members of this body might not find hard to bear, but which represents to those who are already the least among us a significant hardship. In a time when Georgians are struggling economically, when we have the third highest poverty rate, people are hungry and homeless, and the ninth highest unemployment rate in the nation, why are we punishing the least amongst us? The author states that there are two reasons for this bill. The first reason is to identify drug abusers so that they can help their needs. And if that's the case, where in the bill does it provide for referrals to any kind of rehab services for people to test that who test positive? Nowhere does it say this in the bill. This bill has nothing to do with helping people get off of drugs. It is a bill that is creating less hope for the hopeless. The second reason is to not have taxpayer money wasted on drug abuse. That sounds good. Sounds common sense, doesn't it? But here's the reality. The fiscal note on the Senate version of this bill, which I understand they have already passed on the Senate side today, says that it would only save the state $37,000 in funds that would otherwise go to TANF recipients. $37,000, that's it. If you factor the administrative cost of making every county administer drug test, it is unimaginable that this program won't actually cost the state money. This bill is not about saving the taxpayers money or getting people off of drugs. This bill merely is about the cynical politics where we find the weakest person that we can try to scapegoat for society's problem. Vote no on House Bill 861, and let's use Georgia's tax dollars in a more efficient and effective manner. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I yield the well.
The lady has yielded the well. Chair recognizes Representative Johnson to speak to the bill. Representative Johnson.
Thank you, Speaker. I normally really don't enjoy getting up here speaking against a proposal. I would much rather allow my vote to reflect my belief. But as I read over this bill, I find it in one word, troubling. The word TANF, just by definition, we're talking about the poor and the needy. And the average, I heard the author talk about what the normal recipient gets, but the average for a family of three with other limited income is about $280 a month. Family of three, if we use that for food, let's break it down. We're talking about $9 a day, a dollar a meal per person. After they pay for their drug test one month, then they get the windfall of $240 for that month. I'm wondering why we're picking on this small select group of about 4,200 adults. And I'm wondering, are we really headed down a slippery slope? There's other people, obviously, at the public trough. And we're talking about monies we touch. What about HOPE recipients? What about agricultural subsidies? And of course, there's already a public outcry for us to take drug tests before qualifying, while we're serving, random tests. And it's already been mentioned by one of our other representatives that sometimes tests are false. I tested three times to have high elevated levels of potassium until I went to Piedmont and found out they were normal. This will happen on this test. And I really cringe to think about these people having to go to the lab, they're already down and out, and telling that receptionist, I'm here for a drug test so that I can qualify for benefits to support my family. I would much rather that we concentrate on the reasons why we have so many needy and the reasons that we seem to have so many that are applying for benefits right now. And certainly I would think that if we start relying on and concentrating on economic development and on more jobs, that certainly I would like to see some, let me try to word this correctly, some performing enhancement drugs in those areas to build those programs. Thank you, Speaker. I yield the will.
The gentleman has yielded the will. Chair recognizes Representative Waits to speak to the bill. Representative Waits.
Good afternoon, everyone. I think I'm the newest member here today, and for that reason, I felt the need to speak on this particular bill. Unlike many of you, I actually come from a single-parent home, and it is my belief that we must be careful when we start to make decisions surrounding those individuals who are the least of us. It is my personal belief that House Bill 861, would unnecessarily burden innocent families as the state searches for individuals who may use drugs. It is my belief that House Bill 861 would force innocent families to incur the cost of testing and would not reimburse them. In fact, the cost of administering the program would be deducted from their already meager TANF checks. If you look at lines 102 through 106, it is my belief that families cannot afford the cost of complying with this drug test requirement. I believe the families that are targeted by this particular bill are already struggling just to make ends meet. The level of income at which a family receives TANF is half of the level of poverty. Families cannot afford to pay for a drug test, especially in rural areas that often lack transportation or even a drug testing site. I actually understand some of the reasons why we felt the need to put this bill forward, but I believe this particular bill in its existing language is a little unfair. In this body, I've seen many perks. We enjoy wonderful meals and beverages, things that these children can't even imagine. Many of these families are in survival mode. Some supporters of this bill would say that this bill does not affect the benefits of children. But the reality is, you won't get TANF if you don't have a family. So because a few parents who might receive TANF may be using drugs, just like the rest of the general population, I believe it's unfair to stigmatize these families who receive HOPE, or excuse me, TANF. Finally, when I came to this body, I came because it was my belief that we could do things to change the world, to affect families, and to do great work and great things. In the last few weeks, I've realized how disillusioned that I am. I finally asked, remember how you felt when you got sworn into this body, the great work that you wanted to do. I'm asking you to not support this particular bill. I would finally ask that in the event that you have to support this bill, that every member in the House and the Senate be willing to comply with that same drug test and lead by example, and I will be the first to take that test. Moreover, only those test negative will pay for the test, because the bill says that payment comes through the deduction of a benefit. So if you test positive, you won't get that benefit. So who would pay for that test? That may be the most disturbing part of this bill for me. Only those individuals who test negative for the test, because of the language in the bill, that payment would be deducted. So again, I ask you to really consider when you vote for this bill today to look at the least of us. I believe we have a moral responsibility to look out for the individuals who can't speak for themselves, and that is why I am here today, to speak for the least of them. I certainly support ending drug use. I support you 100%. But my feeling is if we're going to drug test needy families, we need to start with state employees, with this body, and many other individuals. I thank you for your time today, and I thank you for the work you do.
Lady has yielded the will. The chair recognizes Representative Holcomb to speak to the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I certainly agree with the goal that is being sought by this legislation, because none of us want taxpayer money to be wasted. None of us want taxpayer money to go to drug use. I think we all agree on that. But I have some significant substantive and procedural concerns with this bill. I want to start with a little bit of background about TANF. Of course, you all know it stands for Temporary Assistance for Needy Families. So these are folks who receive temporary assistance, which is capped out at 48 months. And while they're on assistance, they have to work. There is a work requirement. And back in the 90s, there was, of course, a very intense debate about welfare. And in 1997, Georgia had 83,000 adults who were receiving TANF benefits. Today, and I checked the numbers just earlier today, we have 4,197 persons. So I would submit that what we're doing is actually working pretty well. One of the biggest concerns that I have with this bill, and others have mentioned it, is the fact that we're just targeting one part of our society for these tests. That really bothers me. And we're targeting our poorest citizens. And in terms of the numbers, an individual to receive these benefits has to have assets that are less than $1,000. Less than $1,000. There are lobbyist dinners that you could get around here that are more than that. And this is all that these people would have. I know many of the members of this body are guided by their faith, and I am too. But the message that I hear on Sundays isn't to attack the poor. It isn't to target the poor. In fact, it's to do just the opposite. And what we're doing in this legislation is that there is an assumption that those who are receiving TANF benefits are breaking the law. And I reject that. I don't think that just because someone is poor, one can assume that they are breaking the law. With respect to the legislation itself, let's take a look at it. If you read the purported reasons why we're doing this, let's start at line 15. Whereas the use of illegal drugs by those on the lower end of the economic scale makes it more likely that such persons will remain in poverty and commit other criminal offenses, couldn't we also say that those on the higher end would be more likely to descend into poverty? There's many other groups that we could substitute there, and it's unclear to me why we're only focusing on the poor. If you go to the lines right below that, the same holds true. Whereas serious drug abuse by lower income parents is more likely to result in the children of impoverished families failing in school, developing emotional or behavioral problems, and being neglected or abused. Couldn't we say that about any parents who abuse drugs? There's also concern about the abuse of prescribed drugs. I think many of us are aware that that is a problem, and I don't think that this legislation would impact that. Another issue is with respect to the procedural process by which we would go about doing this. It seems to me like, and I completely disagree with the fiscal note, I think that this is actually going to be expensive for the state because we're going to have to boost our resources in terms of the administrative processes that will be used to go through this. And that's just for the regular startup drug tests. With respect to the random drug tests, how would that even work? Is there going to be a government agent who's just going to knock on your door that morning or show up at your work and say it's time for you to take a random test? And if you don't have something like that, it's not really random if you give notice. Back when I was in the military, we had to submit to drug tests all the time, and you wouldn't know ahead of time, and you would just be called down, and you would have to do it. I don't know how we do that with just regular working people who are going to work because, again, TANF benefit or recipients are working. So I'd like some understanding about how that random aspect is going to work. And I'll also tell you, as someone who went through that, my luck isn't always the best. And I would always get the call after I had, you know. And so then I would have to sit there and drink bottles and bottles of water until I could finally do what I needed to do to take the test. And it can have a real impact on productivity. And so I think we want to consider that as we're working through this legislation. So besides that, there is the small little issue of the Constitution. Our Constitution has, of course, a privacy provision, and a similar law was struck down in Florida. And there are definitely concerns about the constitutionality of whether or not this law would survive. And again, getting to the costs, there is a worry that, and I finally get the joke, so thank you again for the water. So there is going to be a lawsuit against this. And so as we think about how we best want to spend our tax dollars, I would rather spend it in a different way than this, particularly since there are so many parts of this which are very much imperfect. Another thing that we should think about is just the data. While I think popularly, maybe in the public mindset, the folks who are receiving TANF benefits are higher proportion drug users, the data is actually quite different. In Florida, it came out that about 2.5% of the individuals tested positive. Granted, a couple percentage points did not take the test, Nationally, the U.S. Department of Justice estimates that it's about 6 to 10%, so the actual users among this group is smaller. So again, it's unclear to me why we would target this segment of our population to the exclusion of all the others. So there's constitutional reasons to oppose it, there's economic reasons to oppose it, I think there's moral reasons to oppose it in terms of just targeting one segment of our society. But there's another very important reason to oppose this, and it is false positives. And with that, I submit to you poppy seed bagels. Poppy seed bagels can lead to false positives. If you get on the Google machine on the internets and you check into poppy seed bagels, you will see that this is actually a big problem, and it results in false positives, and that's something that we should all be concerned with. So much so, and I found this to be somewhat incredible, the Federal Bureau of Prisons Form BP-529 contains as one of the conditions of being furloughed, an inmate must agree that it has been determined that consumption of poppy seeds may cause a positive drug test, which may result in disciplinary action. As a condition of my participation in community programs, I will not consume any poppy seeds or items containing poppy seeds. And so, in addition to the constitutional reasons, in addition to the economic reasons, in addition to the moral reasons, there is a strong culinary reason to oppose this bill, and that is the poppy seed bagel. Mr. Speaker, I yield the well.
Gentleman has yielded the well. We have members that now have signed up to speak in favor of the proposition. The chair recognizes Representative Ramsey to speak to the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I will be very brief. I know there are a number of members signed up to speak. First, I'd be remiss if I didn't commend the author and Chairman Willard and his committee on some excellent work on this bill. Sometimes it's a good thing to not be the first state to enact a policy. You have the benefit of seeing what courts have done and what issues have been raised when other states have attempted to do it. And I think you guys have done an excellent job of addressing the privacy and the Fourth Amendment concerns in crafting this bill. Folks, we are in tough times right now. We have an absolute obligation to protect taxpayer dollars. But beyond that, we also have an obligation to make sure that our critical social safety net programs like TANF are working and reaching their intended benefits. And many of the speakers in articulating what TANF dollars are used for are exactly right. These are for folks that need help with the necessities, the food and the shelter and the clothing. In their time of need. It's also to support their children, to make sure the children have the food and the clothing and the shelter that they need. And if we have an opportunity to identify those that are diverting that money to drug use and help those children get those necessities, I think we absolutely have an obligation to do it. Now, we've heard talk about the cost. There's a fiscal note from the Senate that says we'll only save $30,000. I'll be perfectly honest with you, if we don't save one penny to this state, but we identify dollars that are going to recipients that are using drugs and using it to support their drug habit, but not giving that money to kids, and this bill redirects those dollars to a guardian that can get those kids the meals they need and the clothing they need and the support they need, I think we've done a good thing for the citizens of the state of Georgia. We've done a good thing for the taxpayers, and we've done a good thing in carrying out our responsibility of making sure that the dollars in this state are being spent in the manner they are intended to. Now, we often joke around here that anytime a bill comes up that it's for the children. I absolutely positively believe on this bill it is for the kids to make sure that this social safety net program is working as it's supposed to. It's being used for the purposes for which it's intended. Necessities, food, clothing, shelter, and that's exactly what it does. I commend the author of the bill and urge your favorable vote on this measure. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Chair recognizes Chairman Cooper to speak to the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Ladies and gentlemen of the House, I know that any time we have a bill like this, it seems to come down we're divided. One party thinks one way and the other party has another issue. But I come today asking you to look at this through a different lens. It really is truly about the children. And I would like for you to look at this as not punitive, but as a chance for intervention and to be able to change people's lives. You know, we're talking about our drug courts. We have a new group that's working with our mental health system. And one of the things that we're going to have in this state is an early intervention process. People who get drug treatment are more successful. Sometimes they do fail and have to go more than one time through drug treatment, but they're more successful than people who have diabetes and trying to get their diabetes under control. So drug intervention works. And if we can identify a parent who has a drug problem and refer that person to treatment while protecting the children, we're on the way to a better life for all of those, for the whole family. Today in the Marietta Journal, I want to tell you about a family, a single mother with five children, the youngest 3 months old. And when they intervened in what was happening in that family, they found those children in a house infested with roaches. They were climbing the ceilings. When the children were sick, the four oldest had asthma, and the baby had a virus that was much more serious. And the mother, in an inebriated state, and as a psychiatric nurse, what it sounds like to me, also with drugs, tried to show the officers the medicine. When she opened the drawer, after great difficulty of even opening the drawer, the roaches went everywhere. There were also four puppies in that house, and the house was covered with dog poop. Now, those children have been removed from that home, and hopefully, one of the things with DFACS is to do is to recommend how that mother can get on the road to get those children back, is to tell them what steps they have to take and how they have to change their behavior to regain that family. But those children have been removed to a safe environment, and the TANF funds follow the child. So that money goes to the family, the grandparents, an aunt or uncle who have been checked out, so that they can have those children have a warm, safe environment with enough food to eat and clothes on their back and not in a roach-infested house. Now, we've talked about the fact that we've got about 5,000 people on TANF, and that those on drugs is about to 6 to 10%. Let's say it's 10%, and it's 5,000. That's 500 parents that are on drugs, and that's 500 families, children that are at risk of not having enough to eat. There was almost no food in this house, and what was in the refrigerator was bad. You know, I come to you with a love of children in my heart. I see this not as punitive, but as an intervention to do what we're supposed to do as a state, and that is to protect those that cannot protect themselves, and that is our children. And I see it as a way to start helping these people get on a road to recovery. I appreciate your attention. I ask for your favorable vote, and I yield the well. Thank you.
Lady has yielded the well. Chair recognizes Representative Taylor to speak to the bill. Representative Taylor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise today to oppose House Bill 861 this afternoon. You know, I've heard that this bill is about the kids. You know, it's about the kids. Let's think about the children. You know, I'm concerned about the children as well, Mr. Speaker, but I'm also concerned about the kids in homes of parents who are alcoholics, who are beating them, or parents who are strung out on prescription drugs. This bill is not about children. This bill is about a stereotype. We've received dozens of pieces of paper on our desk today about different facts, about the bills that we're going to vote on. Not one piece of paper I've received about a necessity for this bill, that there's some idea out there just because you're poor, then you're going to be strung out on drugs. This is nothing short of an attack on the poor. Simply being poor is not a basis for suspicion of being abused on drugs. There's also no fiscal note on this bill. We heard that there's no administrative costs because the people will pay for the test themselves. There will be administrative costs. You have to train workers to be able to receive this information and to be able to direct whoever they need to the appropriate resources to get treatment. The cost of these tests, we've heard, can cost $30. But if you've got to be tested and tested and tested and confirm the correct test results, we've heard of the poppy seed problem, then it's going to cost you more than $30. Who's paying that cost? And we're so concerned about the money, the money that should be going to feed these children. How about the money you're taking out of the pockets of people who aren't abused on drugs so that you force them to take a drug test? What about those dollars? Those dollars aren't going to feed kids. Those dollars are going into the pockets of drug testing companies who are probably behind this bill. It'll cost us, some states, some businesses estimate as little as $20,000, some as much as almost $80,000 to catch one employee, one person who's on drugs. All the testing, all the random testing that you do could cost you tens of thousands of dollars, tens of thousands of dollars that are coming out of the mouths of these children that we're so concerned about. Tens of thousands of dollars to catch one person. Doesn't make any sense to me. This bill, several whereas clauses talk about encouraging a drug-free lifestyle, and that the state has to take responsibility for breaking the cycle of drug abuse. I haven't heard anything about treatment. I haven't heard anything about referrals to treatment programs. Haven't heard anything about the social services that would go along with identifying someone who's a parent of a child and they're abused on drugs. Haven't heard anything about that, but we're so concerned about the kids, we're so concerned about drug abuse in this state, haven't heard one word about that. I want to talk just briefly as I wrap up about the problems, the problems with these chemical drug tests that this bill mandates. First of all, it doesn't identify alcohol. We have parents who are alcoholics, who abuse their kids every day, who spend that money that you're worried about that's going to marijuana or crack cocaine, they spend it on alcohol. And this test, this chemical test won't identify alcoholics. This chemical test won't identify the people who live in Atlanta and outside Atlanta and all around the state who are hooked on prescription drugs, who aren't putting that money into their kids' mouths. The chemical tests have many shortcomings, Mr. Speaker. The other is, it's fairly easy to cheat. Sitting at my desk, Googled, how do you cheat a drug test? And guess what I found? Many, many ways to do it. If I am going to take money out of the mouth of my child to buy drugs for myself and my addiction, it's not beyond me to find a way to cheat the system to figure out how to keep getting that money. If we're serious and we want to be so concerned about the kids and be so concerned about people who are hooked on drugs, there's a better way to figure it out. I'll give you one example, Mr. Speaker, and then I'll take my seat. Oklahoma has a better way. It's non-intrusive, it's not random, and it's not taking money out of the mouths of kids. And their non-intrusive system identified 94 out of 100 drug users who came through their program. They didn't have to pee in a cup. They didn't have to take the humiliating step of going in a bathroom and having someone watch them while they pee in a cup. But Oklahoma found 94 out of 100 drug users, and they got those people in the programs. The intent of this bill is not to identify people who use drugs. I think I heard the intent earlier. It's to reduce the number of people who need assistance. I believe that's the real intent of this legislation. We heard a lot about the kids, a lot about drug abuse. But somehow it slipped in that in Florida, 40% of the applications dropped. And that's exactly what you want to do in Georgia. Just because the number of applications drop is not going to mean the number of poor people in this state drops. Just because the number of applications drops doesn't mean that's the number of people who are getting off drugs. If we're serious about children and we're serious about catching people who are on drugs, then we'll have a serious debate about serious ways to do it. This bill is nothing more than a way to play politics in an election year. And for some of you, it may be good politics, but for me, it's not. This bill, Mr. Speaker, tells the people of Georgia, the poor people of Georgia, that we think you're all on drugs, and beyond that, you're on your own. Mr. Speaker, I'll yield for any questions that there may be, and if there are none, I'll yield the will.
Gentleman has yielded the will.
If there are no questions, Mr. Speaker.
Well, you're almost out of time.
I didn't see my light on.
Got about a couple, 3 minutes. Chair recognizes Representative Hurd to your left for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Would the gentleman yield?
I do.
Isn't it further true that under 10F, 90% of the recipients are women?
That is true.
Roughly 18 to 24% are children ages 18 and younger?
That is correct.
That's current data?
That's correct.
Would the gentleman further yield?
I do.
Is it further true that there's a total of 36,657 women and children receiving 10F?
That's correct.
Is it further true that any type of program that will address drugs normally has a component of treatment with it?
Right.
Is it further true that there's no real treatment mechanism in this bill to address the issues once it is found out that someone is on drugs, is there?
That's absolutely right. Once they're identified that someone who is poor and has children who need help are abused on drugs, this legislation doesn't say we refer them to a drug treatment program or we send them to this program. Sends them right out the door, right on their way.
And just one last question.
Yes, sir.
Is it further true that if we are really serious about drugs in this state, that we would put more money in behavioral health for drug treatment?
That's absolutely correct.
Thank you, sir.
I thank the gentleman for his questions. And Mr. Speaker, I yield the will.
Gentleman has yielded the will. Chair recognizes Representative Spencer to speak to the bill. Representative Spencer.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I want to thank the author for inviting me to come and speak in support of this bill. Coming down, you'll see a graph soon here enough, but what we hear a lot of is this is for the children, but what about this is for the taxpayer? We hear a lot of this argument cloaked in the privacy argument of the Fourth Amendment to the U.S. Constitution. This challenge is really predicated on an outdated idea that recipients have either an entitlement or another heightened legal claim on the benefit that they receive from taxpayers. So if you look at this graph, you'll see the dotted line here. That's when the drug testing law went into effect in Florida. Those applicants did drop. That equated to about a $1.8, almost $2 million savings in one quarter. That saved the taxpayers money. That's what this is really about. This is about the taxpayer. In an economy like we're having, and we see more and more public assistance programs being abused, and I'm on the front lines and I see this. I think the overall policy discussion here should be about all public assistance programs and not just TANF. That's what this is really about, not just TANF. Why did we choose TANF? Well, the federal law says that we can drug test these applicants when they come to apply. It's in the federal code, it's there. And also going back to the constitutionality of TANF, it was created by the federal government. Now, show me anywhere in Article 1, Section 8, that the federal government has the authority to create such a welfare program. It's not there, you will not find it. So really, this is about the taxpayer. This is about saving money. And Mr. Speaker, I yield the will.
Gentleman has yielded the will. Gentleman has yielded the will. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. There is a minority report. There is a minority report. Chair recognizes for the minority report, Representative Oliver. 20 minutes for the minority report.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The future of politics is about performance. The future of politics is going to be less about party, Republican or Democrat, and I hope it's going to be less about negative name-calling and bashing one another. The future of politics, even though candidates will have unlimited money in this era, I hope will not about talking about your opponent's wife's haircut, your opponent's dog carrying, or whether or not the 88th time you've produced a birth certificate is not quite enough. Future of politics is about performance. Can we use our money effectively to improve the services to the taxpayer? Let's just agree for a second with Representative Sensor that this is only about the taxpayer. And I'm going to talk about the taxpayer in this issue and not talk about bias and not talk about the 2,000 places in the Bible that we are required to concern ourselves with the poor. And I'm not going to talk about whether or not drugs in this, well, whether or not we assume that certain groups of people use drugs more than others. I'm going to assume for the sake of this discussion that somewhere between 6% and 8% people do abuse drugs. And for the taxpayer, I will say that you should go after the university professors because those 6% to 8% people earn a lot more money than the welfare family that gets $280 a month. Not $700, but $280 a month. You may have been counting the food stamps and the Medicaid. For the taxpayer, I also want to talk about the history of the litigation around suspicionless, that's the legal term, suspicionless drug testing. I was a member of the Senate when we said all candidates have to go be drug tested. I was a member of Industrial Relations where our chairman said, we're going to do this to ourselves, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to randomly come to you, and you're going to go down there and urinate in the medical station with somebody watching you. So I had that experience myself. And I also have experiences with mandatory drug testing in the courthouse down the street because the taxpayer does pay down the street for drug tests in the courthouse in contested custody cases where children are at risk. I know what the cost of it is. I'm talking about dollars here. And I know that this bill does not have a fiscal note. In suspicionless drug testing mandatory cases, both in terms of the candidates, I think that was passed in 90, and in terms of estate employees, federal courts have thrown those suspicionless mandatory drug testings out because there was no evidence. There was no evidence that candidates or state employees had a unique set of drug problems that required testing. All the whereas clauses in this bill, we don't like drug abuse is dangerous, are trying to substitute evidence to make a finding that this group of people, applicants for TANF, are in need of a drug test. It is not evidence. And therefore, the courts throughout the candidate drug test, throughout the state employee drug test, and the Florida case is enjoined and now before the 11th Circuit because there was no evidence that applicants for TANF need to be drug tested. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the taxpayer, I know what conflict costs in courts. And there is a 100% chance if you pass this bill, because partners at King and Spaulding have already volunteered to sue the state on this, There's a 100% chance that this will be contested in court, and a very, very high percentage of chance that it will be thrown out. So the taxpayer will pay for this litigation, which far exceeds whatever $37,000 concept may be called for in a non-existing fiscal note on this side of the aisle. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the taxpayer, I want to suggest to you that passing this bill is a waste of money. I won't talk again about bias or groups we don't like, or whether or not children are helped in the existing child welfare system that saved those five children out in Cobb County, and not a test case, not a drug test case. I'm going to give you five ideas that are going to save more money than passing this bill. We could turn the temperature down in room 341 in the winter and turn it up in the summer. And if you did that in every other building across the state, the energy cost would greatly exceed the amount of money. We mow the highways, the grass, cost $11 million to mow every single right-of-way we're obligated to mow. Let's slow that down. Let's do it on a little bit different schedule, and let's save one of those 11 million routes. The nursing homes, VA state nursing homes, refuse to take Medicaid. In North Carolina, the nursing homes make a profit serving veterans. In Georgia, we turn away $5 to $10 million based on available Medicare and Medicaid money. We can repeal three different programs I've talked to the chairman of appropriations about and save money. And we can go find every employee out there that has been given a car as part of his or her employment benefit and take half of those cars away. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the taxpayer, I want to urge you to vote against this bill. And I will not repeat that this bill may be about politics, and it may be about bias, and it may be about children who really do need help in this state. Our frustration over the drug issue is enormous. And I want to give thanks again publicly to Governor Nathan Deal, who is looking at evidence-based policy discussions on how you treat people who are addicted. That is a science, ladies and gentlemen. It is not about political pandering. Thank you very much.
Lady has yielded the will.
Forgive me, Mr. Speaker. I want to yield the rest of my time to the minority leader.
You have that right. The representative has yielded the balance of her time to the minority leader of the House to give on the minority report 11 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I want to direct our attention to two documents, page 73 and 74 of HB 742, which we just passed. And there's an interesting line on 73 and 74. It says that it gives the listing of how much you qualify for if you receive TANF cash benefits and how much you're actually going to receive. So for an assistant group of three, the standard need is 424, but the monthly maximum benefit is 280. For a group of four, the need is 500, and the monthly amount is 330. Now, this is in a bill that just allocated $19.2 billion. I also want to point out that we are discussing a bill that is four pages and one line. And it strikes me that we have decided to set priorities. We have provided public benefits in this massive document to a range of groups, and we've spent taxpayer dollars for the needy who have airplanes and boats and other trappings of wealth. And yet, as we provide income tax credits and business incentives without any proof of necessity or any demonstrated proof of public return on investment, we have once again in this body declared war on the poor. Now, let me tell you about these dangerous poor people in Georgia. They've infiltrated our state. Georgia has the third highest poverty rate in the nation, 18.52% versus a national average of 15.1%, and for children, it is 22%. In our state, 1.8 million Georgians fall below a poverty line of $21,000 a year, but only a few thousand actually receive help. So why on earth would we want to deny even those few thousand who reach out for a hand? Why would we deny them access? Georgia also has the ninth highest unemployment rate in the United States, so even if they're trying to get a job, they probably can't find one. And yet, when faced with this danger of this insidious enemy, the poor of Georgia, we are asked today to arm the government not to fight poverty, not to fight unemployment, but to declare war on the poor. TANF is the weapon we've chosen, like a guided missile against the least of these. So let's talk about these dangerous Georgians. Let's talk about what TANF actually does. To get TANF, you have to actually make less than half of the poverty line, so half of $21,000. And if you're in a two-parent family, both parents have to participate in work activities, if they can find a job, and if they can't, we make work for them. A single parent can be excused from this obligation, but only if they have a child under the age of 12 months. And if a recipient fails to work, we have a program in place that says they either face a 25% reduction in their grant, so 25% of the $280 a month goes away, or they lose it altogether. So our target is fixed and our arsenal is loaded. And HB 861 first shells the poor who use TANF to eat. Parents who have children who might be denied dinner because of a parent's poor choice. Because let's be clear, no person can receive food stamps without having children. And while the author says this is to protect the children, we can either protect them against the phantom menace of non-existent epidemic, or we can attack the known scourge of child hunger. Or will we feed these children in arrears after we've proven that they deserve to eat? But it would be unfair to single out one attack because we're craftier against our enemy, these dangerous poor. We again hear that it's all about the children. And if it is, then the state should pay for the test, not the children.